Greetings Earthlings, Grimjim C here again. Just going to show you in this video a few of the models that I've built in about the last 3 years. Starting with this one, this is a BMP-1. The kit is by Zvezda. I think originally it was one of Dragon's very old kits from the late 1980s. It's a fairly ropey old kit, quite crude, needed quite a bit of work. I was supplied the kit along with some frill tracks by a magazine editor to write an article, and I dutifully used the tracks, but it was really quite hard work. I'm told the kit scales out closer to about 1/32nd than 1/35th. Unfortunately, the tracks are 1/35th, so I had to modify the all of the wheels to make them thin enough to fit in the tracks, and also the tracks themselves have a different pitch to the sprockets, so I had to do a bit of work there to get it to fit. Other than that, I made some new loops for the tarpaulin here, and new hanger loops out of metal with the actual straps themselves made from just from masking tape. Added a bit of detail to the launch rail for the Saga. That was it really. So it's kind of a generic Arab vehicle, I suppose it could be an Iraqi vehicle. The idea is that it was supplied as in normal Russian green, and the new users have sprayed it with a sand colour, which is wearing off in places to show the green underneath, and the wear was done using stippling with a bit of old sort of fine sponge, and tidied up just with a very fine brush. So that's one of my most recent ones, although not necessarily one I'm the most proud of. So here's another one that I'm not especially proud of, but it's an interesting model. This is the Schwerer Wehrmachtschlepper, or SWS, from Great Wall Hobbies. Some very nice detail in this kit. It really is a well detailed kit. Very fine moulding of the hinges and clasps and things. Comes with some nice etch sets for the meshwork. The wheels and tyres are done as several sort of sections that are sandwiched together to make really quite a nice looking tyre. Other than that, I wasn't overly impressed with the kit. It didn't fit together particularly well. It's a bit of a struggle. As you can probably tell from the rather over heavy weathering, by the time I got to finish it, this is another one I built for a magazine review, and by the time I got to finishing it, I was fed up with it. I just wanted to get it out of the way. So that's a nice kit. I've heard some modelers build these and absolutely swear by them. They think they're wonderful. I wasn't that impressed with it, so your mileage may vary. Next up, this is the Raupenschlepper Ost, the RSO from Dragon. This is their newer kit. This is a nice kit. I mean, there's some very nice mouldings here, a lot of finesse. The Pack 40 75mm gun here is slightly older than the rest of the kit. It's obviously just been taken from their normal Pack 40 kit and fitted into this. I thought it was fine. I've seen quite a few reviews of it where they say, well, it's an older kit, but the gun's only about 5 years old, which is nothing really. Very pleased with it, with the kit in general, although there are problems with the fit, especially of the rear axle, which was nothing like long enough, so it needed to be shimmed with plastic. So nothing too major, it just took a bit of extra measuring and fitting and filling. Excuse me. Other than that, quite a nice kit. The panels here, the folding panels that fit over the driver's compartments, and these are made from etched brass with etched brass clasps on them. Again, lots of finesse, quite a well thought out kit. it really did weather up nicely. It's you know, I'm very pleased with it. It's a nicely detailed kit. If somebody was had facility with painting figures, then they could really go to town on having a crew fighting on this. I think that would be excellent. That's another magazine review, and most of these, in fact, are for magazine reviews. And the next one also is. I'm a bit of a Sherman fan, so this is the first of several Shermans. This is Dragon's M4A3 Sherman. Quite a nice kit. A few silly little errors, problems with things like the final drive covers and things. You can't really see them unless you really know what to look for, so I wouldn't let that bother you too much. Again, you know, a fine kit, plenty of finesse. This one is marked as a tank of, I can't remember now, I think it's the 6th Armour Division. Uses these big numbers on the side. I was actually able to find some photos of this tank, of this, you know, this exact vehicle, and this unit fitted stowage rails to the side of the turret, which I've added, and also there was a star on one side of the tank but not the other, which is why there's only a star on one side. Also, I was able to see that the idler wheels on this particular vehicle were the sort of open spoke type, and the road wheel here is also an open spoke type. So obviously they've been replaced at some point. Luckily those spare parts were actually in the same kit, so I was easily able to just stick them in. So that's always very satisfying. So yeah, I mean that's a nice kit. Miles better than Tamiya's old M4A3. Not quite the same kit, though it superficially looks like it. This is another Dragon kit, and it's their M4 105mm howitzer. Very much the same kind of design as the M4A3. That's a cobweb, isn't it? That's not to scale, can't have that. Very straightforward kit. This one actually, this one has a plastic barrel, but it's a one-piece slide moulded barrel. It looks absolutely fine. I left it in. Again, this is another one I built for a magazine review, so it's straight out of the box. It's the type of thing that you could really go to town on with, and add some details. I mean, things like the you probably can't make it out, the hatch covers have fairly crudely moulded solid handles on. Those could be easily replaced. It would certainly add a bit of pizzazz to the kit. But again, a really nice kit. Fit was pretty good. Instructions were average, but that's Dragon for you. And it's a subject I've been looking for ages. It's an interesting subject, I think. So you, basically it looks like an M4A3, except it has the engine deck here that's obviously from a radial engine tank. Well, say obviously. Obviously, if you know about Shermans, it's that. So, yeah, they're an interesting subject and quite welcome. Next up, guess what? A Sherman. This is a Sherman Jumbo, as they call it, M4A3E2. This is a Tusker kit. Absolutely superb kit. I think Tusker make the best Sherman kits you can buy. Actually, I'll bring the stand a little bit closer so you can see it a bit better. This was built for a magazine article, and is basically the stock Tusker kit, but with a few extra touches. The spare track hangers are from Tiger Model Designs. They're resin, absolutely beautiful. It doesn't really do them justice on here, really. You need to I should have used them on a tank where I could have them open. The markings come from Archer Fine Transfers, and they are for a very well known jumbo called Cobra King, which, as you could assume, was the first vehicle to enter Bastogne in the Battle of the Bulge, and to help relieve the 101st Airborne there. So the markings are from Archer, as are, you probably just about make it out here, you can see there's some casting numbers here, and they're on various places in the tank. These are from Archer as well. These are pretty amazing. These are water slide transfers. You can see them also along here. These are water slide transfers, and they're coated with a kind of resin that gives them some texture. So all you do is you apply them like ordinary decals, and paint over them, and you get your casting marks. And again, there's some there. To give the texture to the turret, I actually stippled it with some Mr. Surfacer, just to give it a slightly rougher effect than it would normally have, necessarily than the mouldings have. Yes, it has a metal barrel from RB, and I say painted and weathered to reproduce Cobra King from a very famous photograph of that tank. Cobra King still exists, by the way. It was found, it was tracked down as a gate guardian at a place in Germany, a US base in Germany, and it seems as if it had been used on an ill-fated raid on some prisoner of war camp and been knocked out, and it had just been used as a gate guardian. It has been tracked down and returned to the US, where it has been restored and put back into its famous configuration as the tank that relieved Bastogne. And a Sherman. This is Tamiya's M51 Israeli Sherman. Fine kit. Not quite as detailed as, say, a Dragon kit, or perhaps the Academy one. I've never built the Academy one. But yeah, an easy build. These HVSS suspension parts here, they're so easy to build, it's almost untrue. They're they only come in a handful of parts, so beautifully engineered. But again, I mean, I have a bit of a bit of mixed feelings about Tamiya. On the one hand, I think their kits are fantastically well engineered, and they fit together beautifully. On the other hand, they can be rather crude, and for example, on this, the jerry can holders here are two parts, a front and a back, which means it's very hard to lose the seams between the two parts. I'd love to see Tamiya really go to town and say, right, we'll never mind ease of building, we'll make it reasonably easy to build, but stick in some etch and all kinds of goodies, just to really, really bring it up to top spec. But still, a nice kit, very quick and easy build, and certainly an impressive vehicle. And moving on. Not a Sherman. This is Dragon's Brumbeer. You might be able to make out it has Zimmerit moulded in. Now, Dragon really seem to love German vehicles, and they always seem to do them better than Allied vehicles. They probably realise that they'll sell better, so it's worth making more of an effort. This was a very, very nice kit, beautifully detailed. Detail was so crisp and well made. It's just phenomenal. Very, very subtle sort of Zimmerit effect on the surfaces. Beautiful hinges and springs here. The side skirts are, these are actually made of metal, and they come in the kit as sort of die cut aluminium sheets, or aluminium if you're on that side of the pond, sheets that have to be assembled. The only problem with this was that the shirts and hangers were a little bit hard to assemble, simply because the I imagine on the original kit that didn't have the Zimmerit, all of the attachment points for the shirts and hangers were in place and it was easy to do. But when they applied the Zimmerit, they covered up a lot of the attachment points, which meant that it was very difficult actually to figure out where these things went. So I had to attach them at the back and then eyeball them to the right places at the front and then attach them at the sides. So it works, but that was a bit of a downside for an otherwise beautiful kit. This is another one of those vehicles that has quite well known markings. There's actually a piece of film that was shot after the war in Italy, in Rome, that shows this particular vehicle in this configuration driving past the Colosseum, of all things. So presumably the vehicle was captured in Rome, and I think it was used, it wasn't a propaganda film, I think it was a drama that was being shot in Rome a couple of years after the war, that was obviously supposed to depict occupied Rome. But this vehicle with these markings, I mean, presumably this is actually just a piece of plate steel that's been found from somewhere else that had these markings sort of sprayed on it. It's just been used as a side skirt. And another German vehicle coming up. Might have to move this back a bit. There we go. Oh, look at this. It's too big to fit. This is Tamiya's Elephant. Quite a recent kit, this. It does seem strange that Tamiya suddenly came out with this kit, considering that Draken have had a very good Elephant for donkey's years. Again, basically everything that I said about the M51 applies to this. The engineering is superb and it fits together just beautifully. Unfortunately, it has some very crude aspects, the hatches, for example, and grab handles. This is another review kit. The review actually has never been printed. I've submitted it, but obviously no space for it. The problem with this, one problem with this, is that all Elephants had Zimmerit. One of the things that was done that made the Elephant, if you like, was the application of Zimmerit. And the kit as it comes does not have Zimmerit moulded onto it. So obviously you can simply roll your own using putty or use an aftermarket set. But Tamiya have actually come up with their own solution, which is what was used on here, which is self-adhesive Zimmerit. And the Zimmerit you can see, I think you can just make out, especially along here, is from a self-adhesive sheet, and you have to cut it out and stick it on. And it looks like it's stamped. In fact, it's a kind of resin, printed resin, that has a texture to it. So it's not the sharpest and neatest Zimmerit. And also, wherever there's an edge to the sheet, I don't know if you can make it out on perhaps the corner of the vehicle here, you might be able to see there, you can just see the edge to the sheet. It's very difficult to disguise those. So, yeah, I'd give it probably 4 out of 10. It kind of sort of works. And if you really can't do Zimmerit, and I must admit I do struggle with Zimmerit, If you really can't do Zimmer, it's a way of doing it. The nice thing is that there are different Zimmerit patterns supplied for different vehicles. This particular vehicle, 102, was captured by the Allies and for many years was on display at the Tank Museum, or not the Tank Museum, the Aberdeen Proving Grounds in Maryland. And there is, in fact, there's a tank overhaul program dedicated to the restoration of this vehicle. So, again, beautiful kit. I recommend it for a quick and easy build. But if you're a real German vehicles nut and you don't really want to have to replace a lot of the detail yourself, then the Dragon one is probably better, and I think they do one with Zimmerit on it anyway. So if you really want that, then that would be the kit to go for probably. But certainly, yeah, if you want a quick and easy build, try this one. Okay, short break there to gather up some more vehicles. This is another German vehicle, obviously. This is Dragon's Jagdpanther. Again, it has Zimmerit. This has a very nice sort of waffle pattern Zimmerit on it. Again, Dragon always seem to really go to town for their German vehicles, and this is no exception. Lovely detail here. Another one that I built for review, and I was kind of running out of time, and I opted for simplest camouflage scheme that was available to me, which is why it's this rather dull dark yellow. I really wish I'd opted for one of the camo schemes that actually had some stripes or something on it. It really does. It's quite a bland looking model, I'm afraid. But again, a lovely kit. The Zimmerit is really nicely done. It's just, you can perhaps make it out here, it's just patchy enough in places to look hand applied. Dragon have really come along with the Zimmerit. Highly recommended kit. This one has vinyl tracks, or DS100, which is Dragon's own sort of concoction of plastic, and they're gluing down again on this side. I must admit, I do prefer the magic tracks for German vehicles, because they have track sag and it's much easier to do with magic tracks. But certainly the DS100 tracks are a lot quicker to use. So continuing with the German theme again, a somewhat smaller subject. Another Tamiya kit. This is their Panzer II. This one is the French campaign version. Again, a nice kit, but not phenomenal. See me saying this about Tamiya a lot. If you want a quick and easy build, then Tamiya's great. You know, you rarely find any fit problems with Tamiya. They go together beautifully. But if you want a really nicely detailed kit, there are better options out there. I mean, Dragon makes some Panzer IIs with far superior detail. So I'm not trying to diss Tamiya's kits. They're okay, and you know, if you don't have much time, you just want to get some kits built, then you know, I can't fault them. They're ideal. But for if you really just want that extra bit of detail, then there's better places. So down to another Tamiya kit. Having said that, this is another review kit. This is a Stuke 3. Excuse me. This is a Stuke 3 in Finnish service. And it's their old Stuke 3 F, is it? But with some additional parts for these logs and concrete armour on the front. And you can't make it out here, but there's some additional armour plating to go on it, and this big toolbox on the back, and a different loader's machine gun, and a commander figure of a Finnish tanker. Not much to say about this one really. The camo was quite complex to do. It was done with reverse masking using blue tack to mask it. Quite a simple and straightforward kit. Looks fine. I'm not greatly interested in Finnish armour, so there's not really much I can tell you about it. It's been an interesting subject, certainly. So we're going to have a bit of a departure here, both in manufacturer and country of origin. This is from Dragon. It's their M7 Priest. Excuse me again. For a long time, the only Priest model has been the old Italeri M7. Is it B1? Based on the M4A3 chassis. Quite an unusual variant that, but Dragon have come up with this, which is very, very nicely detailed kit of quite an important and widely used self-propelled gun. Not without its flaws. I mean, all the ammunition stowage here, this is all moulded in one piece, which basically means that you're stuck with whatever it is they give you. The howitzer itself is a very nice kit, just the same really as the parts from their standalone 105mm howitzer kit. It has a metal muzzle, not the entire barrel, but just the muzzle is metal. A nice kit. I had a bit of a struggle getting the rear parts of this to fit. Needed a bit of trimming, but that may be because I was in a hurry. The side parts are the sort of the side panels are separate parts, so you have to get those lined up pretty well, and the most likely reason for my problem is I didn't get them lined up precisely. I mean, they seem to fit, and there's no filler needed, I think, here on the sides, but something went awry towards the back. So I mean, that's a really nice kit. It's amazing that these haven't been done more often in 35th scale, but after all, they're not German, so they seem to be largely ignored. And this is our last one we're looking at the moment. This is another Tasker Sherman. This is the M4A3 E8 76mm. Another superb kit. These tracks are actually single link, and put years on my life trying to get those to fit together. Again, just the finesse and thought involved in this was just phenomenal. The suspension is pretty much workable. It doesn't work quite like the real thing, but it'll articulate. But it does mean it has, I think, more than twice as many parts per suspension unit as the Tamir M51. The tracks themselves, each link is made of two parts. I've replaced the barrel on this with an RB model's metal barrel. So it allowed me to just mask the end of it here to give the sort of silver band where the recoil would remove the paint. The muzzle brake is also metal. Again, it just gives it a bit of crispness. While we're on the subject of Tasker models, I have to say their 50 caliber machine guns are the best I've ever seen in plastic. They really are the business. You can get them separately, and if you're a builder of allied vehicles, then I'd recommend you pick up a set or two. They're not that cheap, but they're hardly going to break the bank, and they do just look so much better than the sort of horrible nasty blobs that you get from
the likes of Tamiya and even Dragon, which don't make particularly good ones. So that's pretty much it. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope these are interesting to you. I look forward to hearing any comments. Again, please leave comments if you're interested. Please subscribe. There may be more yet. So have fun and keep modelling. And I'll see you on the other side. Bye for now.